think, with the regional tensions. And the idea was that you can look at it from the point of view of these two countries. And when you do, you really should look at it from the point of view of trade, security, and diplomacy as here. And you should try to have a holistic picture of what's going on. Now, from the U.S. point of view, I have little illusions from the point of view of any country here. And one of the projects I'm involved has to do with industrialization and modernization of all world economies and their history and where they're now and where they might go in the future. So I'm very cognizant of the history of colonialism and imperialism, and it comes in many forms. Now, when we look at the issue of the United States Festival, in order to understand what the United States is doing in Asia, you really have to understand where the United States failed in America. Their objective was to create a regional cooperation sphere with Brazil, with the Latin American countries. This might have worked under some circumstances, but did not, because the President Lula's very strong opposition. Him being a union leader, having a very clear view of what had been the U.S. role in that region. He fought it. And he also fought it because the deal wasn't a good one. It would have been an extension of NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement. And you simply added a few abbreviations into that term. And it wasn't of interest at the time. Americans felt that this was a very bad mistake in two ways. One, they should not have tried to create that deal in the first place, because it proved out that the dynamics of the world, the world dynamics, was not in America, it was in Asia. So why would you spend so much effort in a future of fest? And second, they were not willing to change that deal, the framework that they had. It was, many people would argue, very much in the interest of the US corporates. At least Canadians would say so, Mexicans might say so, although both have benefited to a degree from this. But not necessarily those that part of the population that has suffered from income polarization in Canada or in Mexico, and definitely in the United States as well, who are very suspicious about these deals. Now, there was a strong worry for America to come to Asia in that regard. We don't want to be late anymore. We want to be part of this. And actually, I don't think it's a bad idea. The United States is an Asia-Pacific power. And this is something that I think even Chinese would agree with. The question is, are they also an Asian power, and if so, how? When you travel in emerging Asia, most of the jobs being created no longer come from the US. They come from China, one way or another, directly or indirectly. Not all, but many. That has been the case for years. And it's a reality that you simply can't negate, ignore. The US role has been less. The US effort pivot initially, but mainly security driven. But it has always had the trade component, and naturally, President Obama has been pushing the TPP. But to my mind, if you read very carefully those deals and the agreements, it's primarily geopolitics. It may not be containment policy, but it sort of looks at it from, if you are in China, there's no way out of it. And what worries me the most is that it's exclusive. I, for the rest of me, don't understand why there be a role for both the United States and China under the same rule. Perhaps you have to have a very big house then. Better than the containment. I come from Europe. Europeans know what containment meant. You split Europe for an entire generation. So many people were lost, so many lives were lost, so much in terms of economic benefits, lost. You don't want to go there anymore. But I tend to think that when it comes to trade, ultimately, if TPP materializes the way it seems to, we will have a bigger deal, and it will be part of it. And there will be a lot of friction and crying and maneuvering. Even if Philippines becomes part of it, it won't happen under US terms, it will happen in Philippines terms, at least partly. And that means a lot of exemptions. And then you start arguing, well, is this really a free trade agreement at all, or just a list of exemptions? You want to have a rules, you want to have rules, you don't have to have everything tailor-made. But here it seems to be tailor-made, because otherwise you can't get these countries together. So that's the US interest, not to be late, to be part of something that seems to be very positive. The Chinese interest is to sustain their leadership in the area, understandably. In that sense, some people have argued, well, isn't this like the American Monroe Doctrine? I'm not quite sure it's that simple. I'm not quite sure that Chinese would like to see a precedent for their policies from US colonial past or US imperialistic past, or that past that has to do with the Philippines a century or so ago. I think that their models are slightly different. I think theirs was a reaction to the US pivot. It wasn't Belfort all the way, but when Americans took the argument to the next level, they would respond. So if Philippines is taking the territorial argument to an international court, they will respond, or they will not. It's a good response. And then there's an argument that when I see, for instance, my friends in the US talking about the territorial disputes, they often emphasize the role of United Nations, international court, and so on and so forth. But they haven't ratified the United Nations, the law of the sea. So there's a lot of hypocrisy in this, and basically has to do with positioning and posturing of two very great nations in the area. Now, coming to the Chinese point that you mentioned, when I was in Myanmar, I heard similar talk, a lot of it. And I think that it depends. Now, if you look at the present, the way you describe it, I think is very illustrative of those who are cynical or pessimistic or simply resigned with a Chinese president that doesn't seem to deliver the promise that there was an issue in talk. It's rhetoric more than reality. But I look at it historically. There was a long time that the military junta in Myanmar cooperated with Japan. The US was against it, fought it. Nothing much happened until there was the big asset bubble in Japan. Japan was weaker, had to be in. China came in, created a relationship with the US. Now, China's problem is that people who don't remember that will remember the past 10, 20 years when China appears to have worked together with the past administration, the military administration. They no longer remember the Japanese relationship and what that led to. And honestly, I think, from my point of view at least, the Chinese administration, what they want is economic development. But I think that it is a country that's coming out that has not much experience about heterogeneity, unlike Philippines. Philippines has different languages, different religions, different kind of people. China has Han, 90%. Now even Han is very diverse and varied, different languages and so forth. But it takes time. But that won't be enough for those PMEs who are suffering right now. There was a good example of Chinese companies who said, what are we doing wrong here? We launch schools for people in the border. There are schools. And we thought that we would help people that way. So ask, are there students in the school? Well, not yet. In other words, they've learned a little bit about the corporate responsibility, tried to implement it, but it's not yet too far. Things have happened very fast in that regard. I simply think that the Myanmarese story is so bitter and involves so many not good incidents that we have seen in the region that it you won't have a very simple solution in the end. But this one, I do know. Xi Jinping led Miss Aung San Suu Kyi. They want to deal with her since the military is fading out. And if they want to deal with her, they have to deal with her under her terms. And that, I think, will change things. Unfortunately, I also think that Ms. Aung San Suu Kyi got her position by setting out some of her own initial objectives that she thought will not be a national consensus behind her, having to do with the human rights, certain population segments in Myanmar. She knew that if she would go against the army or the extreme Buddhist nationalists, she would have a problem. So she spoke less of it. But perhaps in the long term, you can find reconciliation in this sense. I guess where I do draw the line is that I think that there is a difference between the Chinese presence in formerly colonial countries than those countries where colonial powers once had the presence. We have a similar argument actually in Nigeria. There was a famous central bank CEO who about a year and a half ago wrote in Financial Times and argued that China's behavior in Nigeria is colonialistic. But when we look what he meant, he really meant that the retail businesses were losing a percentage because China was bringing in cheap price products, as were the Europeans. China's doing business. Americans, who were involved with imperialism at the time, or slavery, aspect of it is that China, many people felt, was a threat here until 1997, until the Asian financial crisis. But China did not devalue and acted like the least possible regional actor. A lot of people, I think, it affected their views. China does not want to have a region that's suspicious of it in the long term, because that would hinder its own prosperity. Because it sees itself as responsible, whether it's in the play in the Philippines or not. Now, if you talk about the precise nature of the region as currently, China would argue behind the Pacific, look, this has less to do with the Philippines than with the United States. We are very uncomfortable with the fact that we are being investigated 24 hours a day by a power that is not located in Asia. What if we were to be 100 miles from San Diego and fly nearby, or in Los Angeles? Would this be accepted, or New York City? Of course, the parallel is nonsensical, but there is a sense that we had a century of humiliation, we would never go back. And that's the part that many people, I feel, is assertive about China. But I hasten to add another metaphor to understand it. Even though the one-child policy is changing, let's keep in mind that most Chinese families still have one child. If you put that child in the harm's way, you have to respond quickly. You govern by consent, whether it's democratic, autocratic, party-based, or otherwise. So Chinese may be far more cautious than I think people give them credit as of yet. And there's this feeling that China has a lot of capital. Whenever I go to the U.S., there's a used to be JLA show, and there was always this one joke that, well, they have so much capital. Divide that capital by the number of people they have, and it looks very different. Because in terms of the number of population that they have, it's a lot less. And thereby, the living standards are very different from Europe or U.S. and Germany for decades and decades. So I would be concerned about the things that you mentioned as well. And in our Institute of Shanghai, we constantly talk about these things. They would like China to be far more responsible. They would like that the multinational companies to adopt faster and deeper corporate responsibility doctrines. If not because they're moral, because that's good business. If you want to build long-term relationships, that's how you build them. They also see a lot of changes with the era of Aung San Suu Kyi in this regard. And there's also a younger generation of the Chinese. And this I mention only for one reason, that Chinese policy has been, because of the history of colonialism, non-educators. And you really understand it when you live in China for some time. They don't want to get involved in that way that people got involved when Shanghai was split into pieces and sold to foreigners, so that if you wanted to go to park, they had a sign for the Chinese. You can't have anything like that for the snacks historically, like this. But the younger generation thinks, well, we can respect our history of having emerged from colonialism. But there are times when we probably do have to, if not interfere, be more involved. And it can be positive involvement. And their views would not be that different from the ones you've actually expressed. So I may be needlessly optimistic about this in the long run, but in the short term, I'm a bit resigned, as you are. When it comes to territorial friction, I talked about it already to a great degree, but you mentioned what should the international community do if it wanted to yield an appropriate Chinese response. I'm not entirely sure that the venue chosen for the argumentation right now, it may be right one in some legal sense, but will it be effective one? It may be even efficient, but will it be effective in the long run? I'm not entirely sure about that, because it's putting Philippines against China in a venue that's not really needed, because this is a confrontation or a friction between two major powers. And Philippines is only guilty by association in this regard. And when Philippines takes a strong position regarding this, it looks more so. But my hunch is that on the Chinese side, there is perhaps increasing understanding that this kind of friction does not go away. You have to deal with it. The more committed people are to their views, the tougher response it requires. Now, if you want to have a tough response, but you don't want to have a security-driven response, you have to start thinking, must start thinking about the real stakes here. And my thinking is that ultimately it is the regional peace that matters the most. You cannot have prosperity if you don't have regional stability. expenditures for the military are still a fraction of that in the United States, and it will take a long while before they come even close to the level, assuming Chinese people want it in the long run. And I think that China's values in the long term are different, but they want to be a strong nation, and they want to be regarded as such, and they don't want to have foreign interference. So the question is, can you find a way out that's a little bit out of the box? We know that certain things will proceed with the international venue that Philippines has chosen. Certain things will proceed that China has chosen, partly to avoid escalation, partly to take part in it. But I think now we really don't know what will happen next, and that has to do with the one slide I presented about the continuity. The policies that were created by the Philippines regarding the friction, territorial friction, happened in a different era. Now we are at the crossroads. I think this is actually very good, because it means that the old structures are no longer rigid. There is change, institutional change in the Philippines. There's some change also in China. There's a major change in the United States. That's a good moment when you have to reflect and think that, well, let's continue with this policy stance. We do not want to give an impression that we don't respect our own sovereignty. But let's find a way to reconcile that position with cooperation and how that could happen in practice.
Depending on the follow-up to that, you mentioned about
it.
Sorry. Okay. As you've mentioned in one of the slides, so the emerging economies are driving the economic wheel at the moment. Are we seeing a transition to an international world order here? Is this something short term or a long term one?
The
emerging economy is driving the economic wheel mostly with
global, across the region.
Yeah.
Global. I think that has been very clear for the past 10, 15 years. At the time, Peterson Institution in the U.S., which was very strongly behind the free trade agreements and all of these, they were pushing it. And the view that emerging economies are now accountable for much of the growth, it doesn't really take it seriously enough. I think that the notion of the BRICS economies, that's the game changer. Yeah. Jim O'Neill came up with the notion of, when I met him, realized we did it both at the same time. He was in London during the time of September 11, 2001, and he saw the plane skip the World Trade Center. And he started thinking that, is this really the way it has to happen? That the positive globalization we've had could change so dramatically. And if so, how could it prevent it? And he thought that while we see that there's a greater potential for emerging economies, you need new policies, you need new institutions, you need governance reform in world trade, IMF, WTO, and so on and so forth. I think he was too optimistic about those changes and the pace that they would have. I think he was also very much for the view of the financial sector that certain activities that BRICS have is good, and much more open for our neoliberal change. I disagree. I was also in New York City, September 11, that day when he had the terrorist attack. I walked down to from Midtown, where I lived, to World Trade Center. And it was very instructive. Everything was leveled down. There was nothing left. I had been in the Middle East in the 70s and 80s, and I was one of those neurotic New Yorkers who would go to the subway and always feel uneasy when there was a basket, there was a package, there was something you didn't know what was inside. And I would tell somebody, look, you know, at some point there's going to be a problem, and people would laugh at you. And then it was. And that evening I walked from World Trade Center in Wall Street to Times Square, and I counted 8 people, several tanks, submachine guns. Normally at that time of the year you have tens of thousands of people enjoying the, you know, the Broadway theater and the crazy scene that's Times Square. And then you've got a good idea where this could go without the right policies. Naturally, both of us understood and thought that the terrorist attack, everything about it was wrong. But it attacked World Trade Center for a reason. It wanted to have something that does not represent world trade, something that does not represent world investment, and so forth. This much I would grant in contrast to Jim O'Neill. I think that we have to really take far more seriously the idea of reforming international institutions. country like China doesn't see change that happens fast enough, how about far much smaller emerging economies or developing economies that are tiny? And especially in this kind of situation where the one thing, commodities, that they have industrialized has been so helpful for their living standards in the long run. Now they don't have even this. And we are beginning to understand what this means. Every time I read my Business Day online, the Nigerian leading Business Daily, I fear of the next attack of Boko Haram and how this kind of destabilization, what it might mean. And as I mentioned, the creation of these Chinese-sponsored or Chinese-led alternative multilateral financial banks, I think these are logical to the new order. And I think that it's actually very good that China decided that the leaders cannot be just Chinese, that there should be Indians, there should be other people from emerging economies from Africa and so on and so forth. And that they don't institutionally have to work in China. They can be elsewhere, and they should be. But time will tell whether these policies prove to be flexible and far-minded in the sense that we didn't see the situation in Myanmar. If you can show in these multilateral institutions that yes, we can be internationally responsible, it's not that we don't want to be internationally responsible, but we don't want to accept the terms that were created by the formerly colonial powers. Why shouldn't we? We want to create our terms, but we also know that there's one Chinese for every fifth person in the world, but four-fifths are something else.